morning, everyone. Let's open our service with prayer. Father, we thank you, Lord, for this appointment that you've made with us to come together in your name. Lord, we thank you that you said if two of us gathered, you'd be right here in the middle of us. So we welcome you this morning. We pray that in your presence, Lord, that we'd be changed and that we'd bring glory to your name. In Jesus' name, amen. Holy is the Lord, the Almighty.
He was and is and is to come.
He is worthy of glory and honor and power.
He created all things, and I his open hand to be.
Worthy is Christ, the Lamb who was slain.
Worthy to take the scroll of my great seals.
By his blood he purchased for God.
He will inherit the grace and the home of every foe and nation.
Christ made them a kingdom. And they shall reign on earth forever.
Amen. Amen, Lord Jesus.
God's made us his people through our baptism into Christ, living together in trust and hope. Let us confess our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Of the Bible, Zacchaeus. This is Zacchaeus.
Hey there.
Who was a tax collector and very rich. Tax collectors were hated because many people thought they were liars and cheaters.
Boo.
Zacchaeus lived in Jericho, and one day, Jesus was passing through Jericho.
What's going on?
Jesus is here! Woohoo!
Zacchaeus wanted to see who Jesus was.
Hey, excuse me.
Hey, watch where you're going.
But he was too short to see above the crowd.
Ah, that's it.
So he ran ahead to a place where he knew Jesus would come. He climbed to a sycamore tree so he could see Jesus. When Jesus came to that place, he looked up and saw Zacchaeus in the tree.
Oh, hey there, friend.
Who, me?
Yeah, you.
He said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry and come down. I must stay at your house today.
Oh, all right.
Zacchaeus came down quickly. He was pleased to have Jesus in his house. All the people saw this and began to complain.
Ugh.
Look at the kind of man Jesus stays with. Zacchaeus is a sinner. But Zacchaeus said to Jesus, I will give half my money to the poor. If I have cheated anyone, I will pay that person back four times more. Jesus said, salvation has come to this house today.
What?
This man truly belongs to the family of Abraham. The Son of Man came to find lost people and save them.
Our gospel reading is from Mark chapter 1, verse 21 through 28. Jesus, Simon, Andrew, James, and John went into Capernaum, and immediately on the Sabbath, Jesus entered the synagogue and was teaching. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority and not as the scribes. And immediately there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, what have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God. But Jesus rebuked him, saying, be silent and come out of him. And the unclean spirit, convulsing him and crying out with a loud voice, came out of him. And they were all amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, saying, what is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him. And at once his fame spread everywhere throughout the surrounding region of Galilee. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise be to you, O Christ.
Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word that's a light unto our path. Lord, we thank you for your word that's the bread that we need. We pray, Father, that as we hear your word, that we'd be able to receive it by your Holy Spirit, apply it to our lives. In Jesus' name, amen. So, you know, when we see something that's been handcrafted, it usually brings a sense of appreciation to us. And today we live in an era and a time where things are just, you know, popped out of a factory, sort of cookie cutter style. And of course, one of the things that's happening is as factories use computers and computer models and stuff, the designs are getting better and better. But you know, 50, 75 years ago, when a cabinet was being made, or maybe even 100 years ago, when cupboards were made, they were made by hand. And sometimes you look at that kind of workmanship and the craftsmanship, and you're just like, wow, that's amazing. In Ukraine, when we lived there, it was like we stepped back in time by like 75 years, because everything was still pretty much made by hand there. Things like, you know, if you wanted, I have a cross, I wear it on Christian holidays. And if you look at it, it's intricately, it's beautifully made, it's amazing, and it's handmade by a jeweler. Well, I think most of us like this kind of thing, and for men, I'm not sure that ladies feel the same way, but like if I look at a gun that's precision made, especially if it's got engraving and stuff on it, I just get a sense of like awe that someone could actually make something like that. Or if I see a piece of equipment that's running like a precision engine in a tractor or some kind of machinery, it just brings just a sense of like, wow, that is really cool. Or maybe a handcrafted cabinet or box with all kinds of design on it. Well, one example I have of something that's handmade is my bishop staff. When I was consecrated bishop, the archbishop told me that I would need a staff. And so I went online to look at staff to see how much it would cost. I was shocked to see that they were thousands and thousands of dollars. Some of them were gold plated and they're very intricate. And I thought, you know, Mary and I talked about it, and I said, you know, the ministry that God has called me to and us to is basically to people in developing countries and the deaf, and this role as a bishop that I have in the United Anglican Church is specifically for those in these developing areas, and especially for the deaf. And so I felt like I don't need a staff that's going to be this sign of wealth and this sign of prosperity. What I need is a wooden staff that is still a symbol of the office and yet not so gold. So I called up my brother in Florida and I said, you know, I need this staff. I need it to be just made out of wood. And sort of tried to explain to him what I was thinking about. And I expected, this is what I expected. I thought he would go out in the woods because he carves things and he makes things. And I thought he'd go out in the woods, he'd find me a nice branch, he'd cut it off, he'd sand it down, and he'd find just the right branch. It had sort of a curve to it, and I would have basically a staff made out of a piece of tree. And to my amazement, he made me something very, very beautiful. He did make it just out of wood. And I have it here. I have it in half right now because he made it so that I could travel with it, so that when I went to Cameroon and places like that, I could bring it with me. And he made it out of, I think he told me that it was 16 layers of wood. He laminated it and he curved this himself. And he put these designs in it. And here, he put a cross down into the wood and a little piece of stone right there. And then he put bands here like this. And I'll be honest, I feel this thing and the different colors of wood and how beautiful it is. I'm just amazed. I get a sense of awe at the workmanship that was involved in this. And of course, the fact that he made it for me and the ministry that God called me to makes it even more special to me. Another example I have is I was in Liberia at a conference, and at the end of the conference, I was the main speaker there, and it was a wonderful time in the Lord, and they presented me with a African outfit to wear, which I actually will probably never wear, unless maybe I'm there at their conference, but they also presented me with this beautiful cane, and this is made out of the wood ebony, so it's black wood with some browns in it, and just the idea that someone made and carved this. It's an African woman with a hoe on her shoulder, and then it has a lion face on the part where you put your hand. And it's quite beautiful. And again, I think it's beautiful because of the fact that someone made this with their own hands and their own design, right? Well, of all the things that we could possibly appreciate, whether it's embroidery, you know, making something out of a single strand of yarn or out of a piece of cloth or a beautiful painting that just makes you feel like you could be inside of it, you know, none of these compare to the amazing, wonderful work that God has done in creating people, right? All of creation God made, and it's a work of art. It's blended and beautiful together. But of all things, humanity is the crescendo of God's creation. In Psalm 139, David is marveling at the wisdom, the power, the incredible, amazing craftsmanship of God. And he sees it at work in us. And he says, basically saying how wonderfully our God works. He's knitted each of us, and he knows all of our days. And it says here, it says exactly right, you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. And, you know, I'm amazed when I see someone able to take yarn and make something out of it. I have a sweater that a lady in Ukraine made for me. And it once upon a time, it fit me really well. But it's just a beautiful sweater. And it looks as nice as any store-bought sweater you could imagine. And she made it, and she just went to work with her yarn and made this for me. I'm amazed at that. So consider the incredible God who took basically, right, the fundamental atoms and strands of DNA, and he knit them together to create you and me. And he didn't make us just as like biological machines that had a task to perform from various parts. Instead, he made who we are, our individuality, our personhood, our soul, our spirit, our emotional, our mental makeup, that is, our innermost being. As I said in my letter this week, God is a master designer. And I talked a little bit about how our bodies are better than machines. And, you know, the list could go on and on and on if you listed how incredible our bodies are. I mentioned that our hearts are like a machine. They tirelessly pump. And by the time we die, our heart will have beaten more than 2.5 billion times. And our blood vessels, like even the little tiny capillaries, if you took those vessels out and you laid them end to end, they would be so long they would go around the entire globe. All of that inside of our human body. And of course, a not so pretty subject, right, is our stomach with 35 million glands, and it produces a digestive acid that's so powerful could dissolve metal. And yet the body is so perfectly synced that it does just the right amount with just the right thing so that it doesn't dissolve itself. And then our bones are masterfully designed. They have cushions and lubricants in them, over 200 of them together. And even today, it would be a wonder if modern science could replicate this amazing design and structure of our body. In our brains, there's just nothing to compare them to on the earth. The human brain has a collection of 100 billion neurons, and they're all linked together with 25,000 other neurons that can process 70,000 thoughts a day. The best computer in the world, while it might be able to compare just simple computing something, it could never do what our brains do, which is have abstract thought and have past memories and imaginations about tomorrow. And it's an incredible body the Lord has designed when he's made human beings. But as incredible as the construction of our bodies is, the most important thing that God created was the inmost being. And that word, where it says he created our inmost being, that word in Hebrew is meaning the what makes us who we are. Our minds, our soul, our personality, right? And as wonderful as our bodies are, they're just simply tents to take us to on our journey so that we have somewhere to live in our journey on our way to be with the Lord forever when we return to him. And every person that God has made, this inmost being, is unique. Like snowflakes or sand on the sea, there's no two people that have been made the same. We have the ability, amazing ability, created in the image of God, to choose, to like, to dislike, to give ourselves to the Lord, to withhold things, right? And so I think one of the things that reminds us of, right, is because God built this into our design, this uniqueness, we shouldn't be distraught when people around us don't think like we think, don't like what we like, where they perceive something different. Sometimes it can be really frustrating when family or friends, people that we think highly of, and all of a sudden we find that we're on two totally different pages about what's happening even, say, today in the climate that we live in. And it's okay. It's okay if people don't think the way we think and don't perceive the things the way we perceive them. They're unique. God made them that way. And it's okay that it's like that. Thank God, in a sense, right, that we're not all the same, that we don't all walk in lockstep. And, you know, an example of this ability to for two people to hear something exactly the same and have two very different perceptions of it is in music. For instance, I have very clear-cut ideas of what music moves me and what music does. Well, sometimes they both move me just in different ways. For instance, I like classical music. I like different kinds of music, but the kind of music that moves me is country music, old-time country music, southern gospel music, the sound of banjos and basses and accordions all playing together. There's something that does inside me. It's like, oh, that is great. And the same way, though, there's a lot of kinds of music that you put it on and I want to leave the room. Rock and roll, almost every kind of rock and roll except 1950s rock, makes me want to run out of the room. And you name it, there's a list of music. Mostly, anything that's not on that list usually makes me want to run out of the room. Jazz makes me want to hide or put my head under a pillow. Well, how can this be? Other people will listen to jazz or to rhythm and blues, and they get moved in the same way that music moves me. Well, there's nothing wrong with that. It's simply that God has made us with our own personalities, our own abilities to perceive things, and because this person doesn't like the same thing I like, doesn't get moved by, doesn't perceive it the same way, right? Taste, right? Sounds, even politics. It shouldn't be something that would make us want to despise that person or say, well, you're not the good person, you're not the right kind of person because you don't think like me. Because what that does, I think, is it devalues the fact that God himself made humans to be so very, very different in the way they think and the way they perceive things. So I think what we want to do is we want to be able to look at other people, recognize the fact that God made them different and made them unique, right? Now, under our breath, we can still say, oh, yes, God made you unique. You're wrong, but unique. Well, one of the questions that comes up when we're talking about God making us and that God formed us in the womb is, what about those with genetic defects? And what about, you know, all the terrible things that go on in human bodies that aren't good? How do we understand that we're made by the Lord and yet people have all these kind of problems? Well, this question really is the same question as to why is there destruction and death and deterioration and decay in the world? Why are all these terrible things? People say regularly, they say, well, if there's really a God, or if there's a loving God, then how can these things be? How can all these disasters and stuff be taking place? How can all this death and destruction be happening if God's a loving God? Well, the answer is that God isn't to blame for the death, destruction, and the decay that's going on around us, not in the world and not even in the human body. Because when God made things, right, in the book of Genesis, when he was done making things, what did he say? And it was good. It was good. It was perfect. There was nothing wrong with it at all. And when Adam and Eve sinned and willfully disobeyed the Lord, they loosed sin into the creation of God. And right now we live in a world that's fallen, it's been tainted and polluted by sin. And even in our creation, right, everything may have been perfect, but now we have this power of sin at work in our world and even in our human bodies. David says in Psalms 51, he says, surely I was sinful from birth and sinful from the time my mother conceived me. And that's a truth. It's like our confession as well as his confession. So when we see weaknesses and defects in humanity's physical nature and destruction and death in our world, in the world around us, what it should do is it should underline the terrible cost and the terribleness of sin, right? And it should also remind us of the goodness and the graciousness of the God that we serve, who's holy and righteous, who gave physical life to sinners like us. And he does it, well, he gives us life with the very intention that he could give us the life that will one day and one time will completely restore his creation on that great day of the Lord. It will be completely restored. He does it with every intention of saving us from the sin and the death and the corruption that sin has brought to us and to our world. So let's consider, what does it mean that God created us? What does it mean to us? Well, one of the things that reminds us is that we're here because God placed us here. There's no one here by accident, and the people he's put around us aren't here by accident. In our world that we live in, the Lord has given us purpose and destiny. He's created us to have effect. Now, keep in mind, right, the sinful world we live in can sometimes try to warp and try to steal the destiny that the Lord has from us. And it's only as we yield to the Lord, surrender to the Lord, to his Spirit and to his Word, that we fulfill the purposes he has for our lives. But if we'll do that, then God will use us to bring about his will in and around us. So the other thing this reminds us is we picture God, and you know, we picture God forming and creating us in the womb and choosing us even before the foundations of the world. It reminds us, right, that life has the touch of divinity, the hand of God, the Almighty God, has made humanity, has made human beings. And so that means that we're incredibly valuable. You know, sometimes we struggle with not feeling so valuable and wondering if anything we do even counts. And sometimes we look at ourselves and we may not like things about ourselves. But remember this, you are so valuable. God himself was the one who decided that you were going to be here. God himself threw you like a stone getting thrown into a lake. God threw you to this earth so that you would reach this place and you would have impact on those around you. It means that God has been with you from the day you were born, like Isaiah says. He carried you from the time of your birth. He's with you even right now. So life is a divine gift. It makes people very, very valuable. You are very valuable. You've been bought, right? God, the price God paid for you so that your redemption could take place was he paid for it with the blood of Jesus Christ, the most precious thing in the universe. But it also reminds us, right, that it's not just our life that's sacred. All life is sacred. All people are inherently valuable because they've been made by God and they've been made for God. One of the biggest and most tragic lies of the devil in our nation is that abortion is just a personal choice and that it has no consequence. Because it says life isn't valuable, isn't divine, it isn't even life until we say it's life. But that's not true. It's the purposeful destruction of human life that God himself created. Well, another thing it means that God created us, another thing that's meant by God creating us, is it reminds us, right, that God knows everything about us. He knows our days. He knows the end of our days. He knows everything in between, right? The Lord has ordained all of our days on earth, God's word says. Before we were even born, he's ordained our days. So that means we don't know how long we're here. None of us do. None of us have a promise of tomorrow. None of us know whether we're going to have a long life, a short life. So we should make sure that we walk in a way that we remain right with the Lord. So it's always a good thing to evaluate where we're at with the Lord and make sure that there's nothing that would be hindering us. And some people wait too long, right? They're thinking to themselves, you know, I should get right with the Lord. You know, sometimes these people are in church, sometimes they're not in church, but they're people who are just like, they're just sort of going along. In the meantime, they haven't actually surrendered themselves to Christ. Well, today is the day. Now is the day that we want to make sure we get everything right with the Lord and let nothing be between us and God. If there's sin, we need to confess it. If there's a bad attitude, we need to lose it. Whatever we need to do, we need to surrender, Lord, make ourselves available to the Holy Spirit that we could get anything between us. If we haven't believed, we need to believe. Well, another thing this reminds us of then is if we don't know how long we have, we should make sure that we worship the one who gave us life and withhold nothing from him. That's the normal way that we would worship someone who gave us life, right? We should love them with all our hearts, and we should give them ourselves and all that we have. And if we're in Christ, this also reminds us that we don't have to fear the day when we leave our bodies. For many people, this is wrought with a lot of fear and a lot of trepidation. They're wondering what it's going to be like, and they're concerned of how it's going to happen. But listen, the Lord who formed us and watched over our birth, the Lord who's walking with us every day in this life, he himself will walk with us that we can go home with him. So there's nothing to fear, nothing to worry about. And this also, I think, should encourage us that, you know, the Lord isn't taken by surprise when someone leaves this earth. And even if they're very young, or even if it's very unexpected, those are difficult times for us because we just see the sort of right now, and we have a hard time understanding eternity and the fact that their life isn't over. It's just a little piece of it. They have all eternity in front of them. So the Lord isn't taken by surprise. And Jesus, God's word says in John chapter 14, he says, don't let your hearts be troubled, right? Believe in God, believe in also in me. And he goes on to talk about how in his Father's house, there's a place that he's preparing for us that where he is, we can be also. So when that time of preparation is done, then the Lord will take us to himself. So we'll go and join him. So as we consider this, especially this part, the Lord has ordained our days. We should live today like it's the last day we have on earth. We should forgive those who hurt us because that's what God calls us to do, right? It says, forgive my sin as I forgive those who sin against me. So forgive those who've hurt us, forget the past, and enjoy the present. Enjoy life and enjoy what's around us, right? We should live today and we should enjoy today. And that also means we should spell it out and spit it out. And what I mean by that is we should communicate to those around us what our real hearts are, We should tell our wives or our spouses how much we love them and appreciate them. We should tell our children, our grandchildren, our friends. We should communicate to them. We should let them know. We should tell our kids, no matter how old they are, just how proud of them that we are. And if they're maybe if they're a wild child and there's a bunch of areas where you can't be proud of them, well, find something that you can be proud of and make sure that you communicate to them. And especially that unconditional love that says, you know what, no matter what, I'm going to love you. We should also make sure that we warn those we love. You know, we're talking about something very important, which is having life, eternal life with the Lord. So we should warn those we love gently and kindly. And sometimes if we just couch it in the terms of like, listen, I don't know how long I have. I don't know how many days I have left on this planet. Neither do you really. And I want to make sure that you know how important it is that you, whatever it is they need to do, if they need to turn to the Lord, or if they need to come back to the Lord, if they've wandered away from him, if they're living in a lifestyle that's sinful, that they need to turn from that and live God's way. But we should warn those we love because we love them. We should make sure that we explain that, right? So what's the Lord saying to us through this scripture? I think he's telling us, from one of the things he's telling us, is that we should love life. We should enjoy it. He gave it to us as a divine gift. We should value our life and those around us. Should value life, including the unborn. We should rejoice that God's hand is at work in our lives from beginning to end. Not be afraid. Know that even when we haven't been thinking of God, God's been thinking of us. We should celebrate God's hand in that he's made us unique. And we should, in doing so, also recognize that those who don't see the things we do are just simply as unique as we are. And since God himself has ordained our days, you know what they are, you know what I face, you know everything I have to go through, right? Because of that, we know the Lord will walk alongside of us and aside of me. It means we have nothing to fear, right? Though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we have nothing to fear because the Lord himself, the shepherd, the great and the good shepherd, will walk with you. His rod and his staff will comfort you. And the plan of salvation that God has is at work in me and is working in you. And we can thank God that the Lord has ordained our days. We can thank God that the Lord is with us, going with us, and that God's plan, the day will come and the hour will come when everything will be put right, right? And we'll stand in front of the Lord and his eternity will lay out before us, and then we'll look back and we'll see how all of this fit into his divine plan. Let's pray. Father, thank you, Lord, for your promise of your word, and we thank you, Lord, for the declaration and the proclamation that you have created us, and you created us for you. You made us in just the right way that when we surrender to you and yield to you, that we would be useful in the potter's hand. Lord, we thank you, Father God, for this life that you've given us and the people that you've put in our lives around us. Lord, we pray that we would always enjoy and value life, not just around those around us, Lord, the unborn as well. Lord, we pray, we thank you, Father, that you've made us not as little robots to answer, not as a flock of sheep, so to speak, but you made us each individuals and each as unique as could be. And Lord, we thank you for that ability to choose and to perceive and to make choices of different things. And Lord, we want to recognize that in other people that you created as well. Lord, that we would be able to appreciate, Father, your creation. And Father, we thank you, Lord, that you've said that you have everything in hand. You know even the number of our days. And so, Lord, we pray that we would walk, Lord, with that knowledge. Lord, that we don't have a promise of tomorrow. So, Lord, we want to walk in a way that pleases you. Lord, thank you, Father God, for your love for us. In Jesus' name, amen and amen.
as we go from this place, let's look for those opportunities to be the body of Christ, to reach out to those around us, to speak the words of love and life that the Lord would like to speak to those he's placed in our lives. And as you go, may the Lord bless you and may the Lord keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Peace and proclaim the good news.
Thanks be to God.